Listen, I'm not exactly sure what direction we're going to go in. You've got a lot of knowledge, and we've known each other a little while, and we bump into each other at the occasional event and stuff. And you always let me know, what you've been up to. I know you're a busy guy. So, what's your current focus at the moment?
Currently, I've just been kind of a bit of a stay-at-home dad, really. I was, as you know, involved in a company called Excalibur, and I pulled out of that about 3 or 4 months ago now. And I've been just rebranding all my kind of fermented food products, and just got ready to relaunch it again, actually. And I've kind of downgraded some of the range, but just picked the best of the best, really, to launch again with.
When did you first start producing, what do you call it, fermented food products? Is that what you said?
Well, yeah, originally I got involved in, I mean, I've been making sauerkraut for many, many years, over a decade now, and I was involved in the whole raw food movement in California in the early part of the 2000s, and I learned how to kind of to make it there, really. And some time ago, about 5 years ago, I got really excited about it and just started getting really creative with various different recipes and perusing a lot of the literature on the subject, because I'd had such amazing results in my own lifestyle choices as well by utilizing fermented food. So at the moment, I'm not doing all different kinds of fermented foods. I'm just focusing on Jun, which is like a kind of a Tibetan form of kombucha, which uses honey instead of sugar.
Oh.
And I've got three flavors that I'm relaunching with. The brand's called Avatar Alchemy, and we're going to be doing Jun. We're going to be doing some other products, more focused around alchemy and spirituality this time, rather than just plant-based food. And I wanted to do something different. I was kind of had enough of the whole vegan kind of mentality, to be honest. I just think it's a silly idea to be doing something like that long term. So I didn't really want to be associated with it anymore.
Let's get into that. So, what's your views on that?
Well, I was a raw foodist for a long time. Almost 15 years I was a raw foodist from the late 90s, and I lived in California for 10 years, and I think it's a good strategy if you want to detox and you want to move out of that kind of nutritional kind of holocaust, if you will, that most people are involved in, of fast food and the mainstream Western diet. I think it's a good strategy temporarily if you want to detox. Raw food diet, that is. But I was never a vegan. I still always did some animal products in the form of beef products. When I was doing that, I wasn't really doing dairy or meat in America, because I just the nature of that industry out there is a bit more severe than here. So I did it for a while, mostly for just the kind of detox benefits and just the lightness of being that occurs. And then I came back to England, and I started doing a bit of dairy. I just felt like I needed something different when I came back here because of the climate. And subsequent to that, the kind of popularity of veganism prevailed, as you probably noticed. I just think that it's probably a good idea, like I said, if you're coming out of eating a load of junk food, for decades, because you want to move that stuff out ultimately. But I think long term, what I've seen observing people on that kind of a lifestyle protocol is that it's not very sustainable. And some people last longer than others. But I've seen a lot of people run into problems, and I've seen a lot of insanity and, a lot of deficits nutritionally. And I've even seen friends of mine die.
Really?
So I've seen people starve their children, all kinds of mad stuff. So I'm not really, I'm just an advocate these days of eating a mostly vegan, mostly plants, but just a wider range of foods, and just a more normal approach to eating, really. So that might include a bit of fish every now and then, a few times a week. I'm doing some fermented dairy in the form of dairy kefir. I'm doing a bit of like buffalo milk. Not much cheese or eggs really, but yeah, just just some things that fill in the gaps, if you will, that are common on a kind of plant-based diet.
Did you notice a difference in your own health and state of being when you reintroduced more animal products back into your diet?
I did. What I noticed was like a kind of more of a robustness in my overall kind of being and an ability to cope with, in particular, electronic pollution. What I've noticed about people who are especially on a kind of a low fat diet, like a fruitarian diet, is that they get very irritated, very angry, very just crazy. And I think like I feel like their nervous system is not very resilient. I feel like they get agitated very easily. And I think it has a lot to do with the Wi-Fi and all the stuff that we're exposed to these days. So yeah, when I started introducing more of these products, like I got onto like a lot of pharmaceutical grade fish oil and dairy kefir, just much more of a fatty diet. I really noticed my ability to remain calm in stressful environments increase. And I wasn't as spun out by the world, if you will.
I mean, I've noticed the same thing. Some people, they do a hell of a lot of cleansing and eating very light kind of food and stuff, and they kind of become very ungrounded, like you say, and they can
That's right.
sometimes, of course, not always, but you notice these patterns, don't you? They get very kind of lost and, head in the clouds kind of thing, and
Exactly.
emotionally unstable, and psychologically sort of unstable. It's really noticeable. And I've never, it's interesting from my point of view, because I'm not a foodie. I went through a little phase where I was cleansing quite a bit and eating very clean. I went through a little phase, but I've never been a vegan. I've never identified as a vegan or anything like that. And
Good for you.
quite the opposite, actually. I've been into, bodybuilding, powerlifting, boxing, and eating very heavy, dense food, meat and fat dense food. And
Sure.
from my perspective, it's very noticeable. I've got a lot of kind of, without meaning to sort of aggrandize myself too much, that's not my intention, but I've got a lot of very strong kind of grounded and aggressive energy when I want to tap into that. And
Sure.
it's really noticeable when I, not meaning to be disrespectful to people, but the hippie vegan type, it's clear that their energy is a lot weaker.
Yeah, and a lot of the men are very feminized, I've noticed, and I really did notice the uptake in testosterone and just much more not aggressive. I guess I could be perceived as aggressive, but just much more, I don't know, just more boisterous, I guess you could call it.
Well, I mean, what's the thing that testosterone and hormones and stuff are constructed from? What is it? I
From
forgot.
cholesterol, from fat, basically. And you can get testosterone in other forms, but I think that our hormones are dependent on cholesterol.
There's definitely something in that. I mean, I'm no expert, but there's some pattern, there's some correlation going on there, isn't there, between fats and cholesterol and dense sort of food and testosterone. I think
For
so.
sure, for sure. I mean, I think being a vegan when you're in your 20s might be appropriate, might be a good thing. But once you get to a certain age, like when I hit 40, I really noticed that I needed to do something different from what I had been doing. And it unfolded in the form it has now, and I really, really pleased that I did that. And I was still kind of a raw foodist when I started introducing raw dairy and fish oil and some other things. Deer antler was one that I was using. But even beyond that, I ditched the whole raw food kind of diet. Got debunked really in the last few years, and a lot of the people who I knew that were doing it, when I started about 20 years ago, are just not doing that anymore. And The people who looked at the literature, for example, are just basically realizing it's not the way to go long term. A lot of people who go vegan these days are just, to be honest, just jumping on a bandwagon, as far as I can observe, and they don't appear to have looked at the data. They just see this thing, oh, vegan, that's healthy. I'll just jump on that bandwagon, and I don't have to read anything. I don't have to study. I don't have to investigate. I'll just do this, and it'll all be hunky dory. And it's a bit of a half truth, I think, that's touted by people. Maybe it's true to them, but I just think that you have to dig a bit deeper, especially if you're just saying to yourself, "I want to do this for the rest of my life." I think it'd be wise to kind of to do due diligence in regards to the information that's out there, and it is out there. It's at your fingertips if you just look.
I think it's really important to for these conversations to be had, isn't it? Because we've had a long period of time of having having it rammed down our throats and told it's the only true healthy way. And it is really important for people to stay open-minded to the possibility that maybe it's not the ultimate answer to everything. So even though these conversations, to some people, we'll get some flack from certain kinds of people for having this conversation, but I think it's important for us to talk at it from this angle.
Yeah, well, you know my opinion on what people think, Ben. I don't, I'm not swayed at all by detractors. I just say what I think, and I think it is important to have this conversation, because a lot of people are getting led down a bit of a path that may or may not be good for them. I mean, I guess some people do better than others. Some people do better than others. I think everybody's different, and I think you just need to find what's right for you. And I think a lot of what people don't get as well is that there is a mental component to this, and everything in reality, there's a mental component. I think you really have to look at your beliefs. If you really believe in something, then maybe it'll work. Maybe you'll transcend all of the kind of the physicality of it. Stranger things have happened, but I think if you've got a little bit of doubt there, you might want to, kind of honor that belief threshold. I'm a big fan of metaphysics and the non-physical reality that affects us. I think that's really the foundation of it all. Is to really just look at your beliefs and your energy and what you're putting out there, what you're vibrating at. I think that really has a really a huge impact, a bigger impact than a lot of people, particularly people who are on a puritanical path, tend to kind of overlook. So yeah, it's a very interesting situation.
I do want to get into some of your other some of the other spiritual stuff, but just a couple more questions on the topic
Sure,
we were just
sure.
on. Who's some of the perhaps more well-known or higher profile kind of health gurus who have started introducing animal products into their diet?
David Wolf is
Okay.
one. Graham Jevon is another person who's pretty prominent in the health scene. There's a guy called Daniel Vitalis. He's in the United States. He went on to the whole paleo thing years ago. I knew him when he was a raw vegan. That was, I guess, like over 15 years ago now. And it just didn't work for him. So he started doing, dairy and meat and all this stuff. He's doing really well now. He looks great. But he had, the raw vegan diet was a disaster for him. I did pretty well on it myself. I didn't do too badly compared to, a lot of people I know. I did pretty well, I think. But I did notice when like I said, when I did get back onto dairy, and I felt a lot better. I felt a lot different.
When I last saw you mentioned something about gray hair and aging. In the worst instances, in the worst examples, people really age on it.
Yeah.
I mean, could you speak on that a little bit?
Well, yeah. What I noticed on a raw diet is that people do get they go on this kind of whole cleansing, kind of detox lifestyle, for years, and I think that's a good idea. I'm not dissing that. I think that's got some merits. But what I've seen happen way too often is that people just hit kind of like a wall where they're no longer gaining energy, but they're losing energy. They're losing their life force, and like you said, they go grey. They look gaunt. It's just not. It's clearly not working. And oftentimes they're still caught up in this kind of like, this is the best diet ever. And it's understandable that people would think that way because we do start eating that way, no matter what diet you're coming from. Because any dietary change is going to be better than a Western diet. You do feel a lot of benefit, but it's not really so much to do with the diet and what you are eating, but more about what you're not eating anymore. And I think that's really where the benefits are derived from, more than people want to kind of admit. I was in that space as well. I thought it was the best thing since sliced bread. I didn't have, a severe kind of health debacle, if you will. I just was like, I need to do something different now. I'm getting older, and I'd done a lot of research. I'd looked at the literature, and I just decided to make a change, and I'm really glad I did, actually. And a lot of people who are, say, on a fruitarian diet, you might look pretty and have clear skin and be lean and all that kind of stuff, but I don't necessarily think that that equates to being healthy. It's just like more of a superficial kind of appearance.
Yeah, very interesting. There's more beyond just the appearance of clear skin.
Exactly.
Yeah, just a couple of anecdotes because I really want to drill this topic because I feel quite strongly about this, similar to you do. I mean, I'm coming at it from a different angle. I don't have such knowledge on nutrition and stuff, but there was a couple of friends I noticed. And one guy was doing a lot of juice fasting, a lot of cleansing, and he literally went mad. He went psychotic. He had to be taken away, literally.
Oh,
And
wow.
of course, of course, some people are more vulnerable to that than others, depending on
Sure.
their state. Maybe some people might just get that to to greater and lesser degrees. Maybe they might not completely flip out, but maybe they might, like we were saying earlier a moment ago, they might have some lesser degree of sort of mental instability sort of come up. And another friend, very similar situation. I think she was doing a lot of cleansing and she was doing a lot of meditating as well. She went on like a 10-day silent retreat thing, which I know is popular with a lot of people. And she, I think meditation doesn't work for everyone either. Some people go loopy meditating as well. What's your view on that?
Well, I've never heard of people going loopy meditating. I mean, based upon what I've looked at, I mean, I've been meditating for 25 years now, and I've had great benefit from it. I think it's a great thing, and actually, it's now proven through various studies. I don't recall the exact studies, but I know that there's a lot of, peer-reviewed studies that conclude that meditation actually does extend your life. I won't go into the details, because I know people just switch off from that, but it's good for you. I think maybe your friend had some other psychological issues underlying that may have sent her that way. It's a very complex issue, I think. I think there's a lot of factors that could cause somebody to, do that. I've seen people go mental. I mean, I've met a lot of raw foodies, and I've met some insane people. There's definitely some psychological stuff
Just
that goes on.
one more anecdote from a different angle. There's a couple of bodybuilders online called the Hodge Twins. Have you ever seen those guys?
I don't know of those guys. I'm not really a big into bodybuilding, so it's not really my kind of field, to be honest,
Yeah,
Ben.
fair enough. So these guys, so bodybuilding is all aesthetics. It's just about how you look. It's nothing to do
Sure.
with health, nutrition, nothing. It's just,
Yeah.
and so they do. They got a huge following. They got a lot of YouTube videos and stuff. Anyway, they look great. They're natural. They don't take steroids. They just sort of look, healthy. They look great, kind of thing. Really athletic. So one day they decide they're gonna stop eating meat, and And so they make this big announcement. They decide, you know, the ethics, they're just, they didn't want to contribute to the cruelty anymore. And they're going to turn to a, you know, vegetarian diet or whatever. And they committed to it for quite a while. They stuck at it. I can't remember how long, if it was 6 months or 9 months, or I don't know. They stuck at it quite a while. And what was interesting, they couldn't maintain the same muscle mass, and they got more body fat because the amount of food they were having to eat, sort of plant based,
Yeah.
was bringing with it so much carbohydrate in order to get enough protein that they were kind of, and
Exactly.
their body shape.
Yeah.
Now, this might not be important to a lot of people, you know, because it's not really health. It is just aesthetics and appearance. But it is interesting to know that from a muscle mass and strength standpoint, there was a difference. There was a big, and eventually they went back on to eating meat. They were like, look, we tried, honestly, we gave it our best shot, but fuck this, you know, our appearance is too important to us. So it's interesting to know.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I've seen that happen. I just think, you know, a lot of these people who are fruitarians, all of a sudden, if you go onto that kind of a protocol, there's not as many available calories. Even if you're just on a raw food kind of balanced raw food diet with salads and stuff like that, you have to eat a lot of food just to you know get, like you said, the amount of protein and stuff like that. So with fruitarians, what happens is they're just eating, like you said, too much, way too much sugar. You know, 30 bananas a day, and you know, a bag of dates, and 10 mangoes, and you know, maybe a couple of salads a week. I had a friend actually, who was a fruitarian. This was about over 15 years ago now, and he looked great. He was big into yoga every day, five Tibetans every day. You know. Worked out a lot, yoga and walking, not really bodybuilding, but he looked really good. Basically, he was in his 40s then, I think, as well. But he did look good, and he ended up getting a staph infection, staphylococcus, which is basically a flesh-eating organism. And you know that you basically you've got to just get off of sugar. You know you can't do sugar because that's what feeds it. And he was in New York with David Jubb getting urine injections, trying everything. You know, trying to get rid of this. And he thought he was going to die. He was like, he said he was sitting in the in a, an apartment in New York, going, you know, time to go. What a bizarre way to go, you know. And in the end, what saved him was he got there's this drink in America called amazake. Well, it's a Japanese drink made from rice, fermented drink. And there's a microbe in that apparently can withstand pasteurization because it is a pasteurized product. And he got on that. He started getting better. Started getting better, and you know. After that, he wasn't a fruitarian anymore. He still, you know, he still did a bit of fruit, but he was on, you know, just like a kind of a. He's a yogi, so he's into that kind of whole dal and rice thing. So he got onto that, and he looks great now. He's a really, really top yoga teacher in London. He does a lot of privates for you know royalty and all kind. He's really, really got a lot of notoriety, and he had his blood tested when he was in New York. And it had something like 153 different kinds of parasites in his blood. You know, and that's just, you know, eating a load of sugar and, you know, obviously a load of fruit that's got, you know, worms in it and stuff like that. So yeah, this stuff's not to be not. And that's just one story, Ben, of someone who almost died. But I know people who have actually died from the same thing, staph infection. And they were like, yeah, I'll just eat my mono diet. I'll be okay. It'll go away. You know, 10 days later, they're dead.
Jesus.
And this is this guy who's appeared to be super healthy. So you know, I'm a bit of a devil's advocate on this subject with people. When I see them going down that path, I just say, listen, you got to be careful. You got to be, you know, you got to do the research. You know, you can be a vegan. You can get away with it, but you do have to know what you're doing. You have to look at the literature, and you know. Take care of all those different bases that there are deficits on a vegan diet, quite a few of them. B12 being the most famous one, but there are others.
Right.
There are others. And if you don't know about them or how to acquire those nutrients without the use of animal products, I think you'd be very wise to find out.
So, is this where the fermented foods come in? Do they supply those nutrients?
Well, fermented foods are one thing that you could definitely look into, because they do actually, depending on what you're eating, like for example, there's one that is quite a common deficiency on vegan diets, and it's fat soluble vitamins, particularly vitamin K2, which is traditionally acquired from things like milk and cheese and stuff like that. And that's not available on a vegan diet unless you know what you're doing. You can get it from some fermented foods like natto. Natto is a fermented soybean that's a Japanese product. You can't just buy that anywhere. You've got to go to a Japanese store, and then if you go there, it's going to probably be GMO soy, not organic. So you have to make it yourself, and you have to. It's not easy to make. I mean, it is easy once you know how, but you have to figure it out in order to make it. That's one thing. There's long chain omega-3 fatty acid, which is in fish. It's in fish, and there's no really getting around that. There's some algal extracts you can get. There's marine phytoplankton and algal kind of oils and stuff like that, but I don't know if they're really supplying it in the way that fish does. And then there's like with fermented foods again, there's a lot of B vitamins, and I think B12, I wouldn't try and solely rely on fermented foods for that personally. I mean, you can get it from various different sources, but I mean, you're kind of swimming upstream really when you start going into that realm. That's what I figured out. You could do it vegan, but A, it'd cost you a fortune for all the supplements, and B, you've got to read the books, you've got to read the literature, and most people don't want to do that. They don't want to spend the time doing it. So you might as well just eat some animal products if you want to get those nutrients. That's what I came to. It's just easier to just. And the thing, what was ironic for me was that when I did actually get onto dairy and some other animal products, I found that my reaction to them wasn't as severe as they was when I was a vegan.
So, okay, yeah, what do you mean?
For example, a lot of people are lactose intolerant. Lactose is a sugar that's in milk that is difficult for people to digest because they don't have the enzyme capability to assimilate it. Lactose is in breast milk, and children have got the enzyme. It's called lactase, the enzyme to break down lactose. Children have got it up until about 3, but beyond that, you stop producing it. Now, what I found when I got onto kefir, dairy kefir, was that those organisms that produce the enzymes are in the culture. So I don't know this for sure, but what I guess happened to me is that I completely changed my microbiome by ingesting these foods, and I've almost like mutated myself to be able to do milk. I could never do milk when I was growing up. I always had reactions to it.
Oh, I see. So from the fermented foods, you're getting the enzymes that can then process the lactose. Is that right?
Exactly. So I'm able to do milk now. Raw milk, obviously. I wouldn't do pasteurized milk, but raw milk I can do. No reaction
Yeah. I've
whatsoever.
heard somebody else say that as well. There's another guy I follow, and yeah, he says that he pretty much eats everything, and he said when you start cutting things out, your body starts becoming more and more sensitive to those things, and then when you do eat them, you have a bigger reaction, and so you
Exactly.
can kind of end up sort of backing yourself into a corner in the way, sort of narrowing down, the range of things you're eating, and then anything you eat is going to give you a reaction.
Exactly. I mean, I know people who they can't even walk out there. They don't even want to walk out their house. They're so sensitive. They won't come to England because they don't want to go through Heathrow Airport. I mean, like this kind of insanity, you know, like,
Yeah.
yeah, there is some, you know, detrimental factors when you travel on planes and go through airports and stuff like that. But to be imprisoned in your little box of a reality because of the fact you don't want to eat certain things is, I just think, you know, you're here to live. You're not here to be in a self-imposed incarceration.
Yeah, this is why I wanted to talk to you because I really love your kind of balanced view on all this kind of thing. Yeah, but it's true. Some people are so paranoid about what they're eating that, like you say, you're kind of imprisoned in your own. You got there's such a long list of rules that you got to adhere to. It's like it just takes the fun
Can't
out
live
of
in
living.
you can't live in this world, can you? I mean, if you like that, and it's all in the mind. This stuff is, you know, this reality is very malleable, and it conforms to your beliefs. And so, if you get caught up in a very rigid mental structure, then that will be your reality.
I remember watching Bruce Lipton videos. I really like him, you know, the biology of belief guy.
Yeah, he's great. He's great. I like it. I love that book he wrote. It's really good.
Yeah, it's great. If anybody gets a chance to, personally, I don't tend to read stuff. I usually listen to it on podcasts
Yeah,
and
sure.
interviews. I find it easier. But yeah,
Easy.
I really like him. And yeah, the idea that the actual biology of your body does respond to what you believe. I mean, I wouldn't be able to explain that, but he explains it nicely.
Well, it's a field, new field of science called epigenetics. He coined the term, I think, Bruce Lipton. And when he started doing it, you know, he was looked upon as a, you know, wacko. You know, but you know, beyond that time, he was validated by what he was saying, and now it's a, you know, a recognized field of science. And basically, the premise behind it is that you're not subject to your genetics. Genetics only play about 20% of it in terms of, you know, what genes get turned on. But really, it's much more to do with the environment. It's to do with your lifestyle.
Yeah.
And you figured this out by putting stem cells into different environments and seeing how they behaved. I think that's the premise of it.
Yeah, I got from it that there's like we've got a wide range of genetic potential, and depending on the environment that our cells find themselves in is what will get expressed. So you can like yeah,
Exactly.
you can switch on and different things in us will get expressed.
Exactly. Well, if you just look at children, you know, one minute they look like their mum. Next minute, they're displaying characteristics of their dad, and or their grandparents, or you know, it's really clear when you look at children how they express different genetic characteristics. It's a very interesting, you know. I know I didn't, you know, until I knew about this stuff, I didn't really notice it. But you know, looking at my son and my daughter, you know, like 15 years ago, it was very, very obvious that that's what was going on. It's a very fascinating subject, isn't it?
Certainly. Earlier on, you mentioned something about Wi-Fi, electromagnetic, and perhaps 5G. So, what's your views on that?
Well, I think it's you know, it's a good idea to minimize the amount of time you spend on these devices. Now, there's no getting away from it now. It's everywhere. All, the only thing we really can do is make sure that we're you know, not as exposed as we could be. And there's a lot of technologies you can use to counter that. One of the best ones really is just going outside on a regular basis, barefoot or touching the ground and connecting into the ground. Because what tends to happen with this stuff is that it comes in to us, our field, and starts bouncing around like a pinball. And you know, they're called free radicals, and they basically burn us, they oxidize us. So what you really need is a negatively charged electron to become what's called an electron donor. What that does is it stabilizes the free radical.
This is in our body, you mean?
Well, when you're around, say, a computer, or you're on a keyboard, you're being bombarded with positively charged electrons. And what they do is they go in and they start to oxidize us. They start to burn us. And it's kind of the analogy would be like a pinball machine that goes in and starts bouncing around and causing havoc. So what you really need is you need some way to discharge that any energy, or some way to kind of to stabilize it so that it's no longer a free radical. It becomes it basically you put in negatively charged molecules like antioxidants and things like clay and charcoal, and what they do is they'll balance out that instability of the free radical. That's as far as I understand it.
I see.
So doing things like zeolite clay, bentonite clay, charcoal. There's a really good supplement called Mega Hydrate, which was invented by Patrick Flanagan. He's a former child prodigy. He's one of the top scientists in America when he was 18. Invented a product called Mega Hydrate, and it was he made it based upon the work of another scientist who'd been studying the Hunza people in the Himalayas, who have got a very long lifespan, and he figured out it was to do with their water. So Patrick Flanagan found a way to take hydrogen and bind it to a silicon molecule in a specific configuration, like a shape. It's called a buckyball, based upon Buckminster Fuller's work. He found a way to put thousands of hydrogen ions onto this silicon shape, and when you take that and put it into water, it's one of the most powerful antioxidants, and that's a really good counter strategy, if you will, for combating electronic pollution. There's also grounding mats. You've got these mats that you can touch while you're on the computer. And what that does is it allows the free radicals to just go straight through you, creates kind of like a shield around you. And this is what we would have been doing, 100 years ago or more. We'd be connected to the earth. We wouldn't have, rubber soles on. We'd be much more in contact with the earth. So therefore, a lot of this stuff would just get discharged. And obviously, there wasn't as much electronic pollution then anyway. But we figured out that we can stay grounded, much like the way your house is grounded. Then this stuff doesn't affect us as much. Now, when you go out into, reality where you don't have that, you want to get barefoot as much as possible, or touch the ground as much as possible. When you're on your mobile phone, use speakerphone if you can. There's all kinds of things you can do, but I mean, at the moment, we're just kind of subject to what's going on. 5G is rolling in now, and I haven't really read too much about 5G. I've just seen little sound bites out there, and I've had people talking to me about it. And that could be a problem. I mean, I really just don't know what to do about it. I'm especially concerned for the younger people, because it affects people who haven't had as much brain development, more than it does someone who, like ourselves, who become an adult by the time this technology was introduced. So I really don't know what the solution is to that. Other than those technologies I just mentioned, there's all kinds of electromagnetic chaos eliminators, like these pendants you can wear, and stuff like that you can get as well for your phone. But it is an issue. It is an issue.
What other topics are important to you at the moment? Is there anything you're particularly reading or following or just on your
Well,
mind?
I mean, I've been very, very immersed in politics recently, as last few years.
I must say, we've got a very
That's
similar attitude to a lot of things, haven't we?
yeah, exactly. Yeah, especially in that field. I mean, I've just been looking at what's going on in the world, and I've become, I don't want to say I've become conservative, but what I think's really happened is that the left has become so radical that people like me are considered a conservative now. And it's not really about right or left, I don't think. I think it's much more to do with your values and morality, and right and wrong, really. And to me, I don't really want to have anything to do with some of this stuff that's going on. I just can't line up with it in regards to what my principles are. So I just automatically found myself on the kind of right side of the spectrum. And You know, a lot of people, I've had people say to me, "Oh, well, you're a person of color. You're a mixed race person, so you should think like this." And it's like, well, no, actually, I'm going to think how I think. And that tends to be the kind of like kind of attitude on the left. It's like people are the people who go on about fascism and go on about racism and all this stuff are the actual ones who are the fascists and the racists are found, because they've got this kind of, you know, like I said, you know, they're saying I should think like this because I'm this demographic. And
Yeah,
it's not very democratic, is it?
no, it's I think we've got a very similar outlook on all that kind of thing. I mean, I find the hysteria from the radical left totally ridiculous. I mean, and also what I've noticed is like lately, like people such as yourself, and I've got other friends that are, I don't know, sort of got a similar kind of attitude, perhaps a bit more conservative, right leaning, whatever you want to call it, you know, whatever label you want to put on it, objectivist, whatever, you know, libertarian perhaps. I feel a lot more closely bonded, like to not so many people, but like I've noticed I've got a network of really good quality friends that have really stood out, and then the rest of the hysterical sort of left, I've distanced myself from, really, because I find it very unworkable situation.
Yeah, similar. I've had people fall out with me, delete me, block me, you know, including members of my family, you know. But you know what? I don't care. You know, I don't care. You know, I'm sticking to my guns on this one. I'm not gonna be silenced, and I'm not gonna have my thoughts curtailed by, you know, slurs and character assassinations, and I just don't care. I don't care what people think. I really don't. I've got no thick skin, you know, on this issue. And I just think, you know, in the end, the goodness and truth will prevail, and it is as we speak, you know. And what the rabbit hole that it's actually took me down, though, Ben, which is a very interesting one, is this whole disclosure thing that's coming out. I don't know if you've been looking at this, but
No, I haven't.
I mean, it sounds insane, but I mean, and you know, I wouldn't have believed this stuff, you know, a couple of years ago. But David Wilcox, he's just put out a movie called, you know, David Wilcox.
I know who he is, but I wasn't aware of his latest work.
Anyway, he's done a movie called Above Majestic, which is about the secret space program, which, you know, you may or may not believe in, but it's worth taking a look at. I mean, this movie is outselling the new Star Wars movie.
What?
It's got a $50,000 budget, and it's outselling a movie that's got a $275 million budget
So where is it
on iTunes.
available? Where?
iTunes and Amazon, you can see it. But anyway, it's worth checking out. I did see it for free on the internet, but it's been taken down now.
Okay.
But it's basically about this kind of you know, the space program that's, you know, that they're basically saying there's a colony on Mars and there's thousands of people up there. And I would not have believed it, Ben. But about just under a year ago, a friend of mine came up to me in Excalibur and said, "Oh, I was in the secret space program. Her dad was a very high level top secret engineer in the US military, and she said that he basically sold her into this program when she was a kid, and so she was part of this MK Ultra kind of mind control program, and that she was deployed to Mars." And you know, she was there for several years, and there's a lot of details, you know, that were, it's pretty out there. It's pretty out there, as you can probably tell. And you know, at the time I was like, well, she doesn't appear to be insane, and she doesn't appear to be lying either. So I was kind of like, I didn't disbelieve it, but I was kind of incredulous on some levels. And then, you know, after that, I started to see all this material that corroborated what she said exactly. And part of that material is in this movie that David Wilcox just made called Above Majestic, and it's very worth watching, and it ties into what's going on politically in all around the world, and it's to do with extraterrestrials and their connection to the governments of the world. And I think we've got some very interesting stuff going to come out in the next few years, actually, Ben. It's very, very interesting. So I've been doing that as well. I've been spending a lot of time looking at that, and as I said to you earlier, I'm interested in metaphysics, and the mind and its effect on our reality, and I've been doing that for decades now. I've been interested in that. I'm very hopeful. I'm very hopeful at the moment, Ben. I think we're gonna go into the stratosphere in the next 5 years in regards to a lot of the technology that has been suppressed over the past 100 or so years. It's probably going to get released, a lot of it. And I think what we've got access to now, iPhones and all the rest of it, is it's like caveman technology in comparison to what's coming. I don't want to go into the details of it because you can go and look at all this stuff online. I'm not I, That's just basically what I've been looking at recently.
Yeah, fair enough. I used to take more of an interest in that kind of thing, and I used to love all that kind of thing. I used to watch Stephen Greer a lot. I quite liked him. Like just because of my own personal journey, I sort of dr moved away from it just because I needed to sort my life out more, so I had other priorities. But I do find that kind of thing fascinating for sure.
Well, I used to take it with a pinch of salt, Ben. I was like, well, maybe there is, maybe there isn't. It's not going to affect me. But based upon what I've looked at recently, I feel like it is actually affecting, has been affecting us all along. But it's going to affect us very demonstrably, I think, in the next number of years.
Is that because of technology in particular?
I think it's just because of what's happening in regards to the purging of all the elites that's happened since President Trump was elected. You're going to see mass arrests any sometime soon, very soon. You're going to see a lot of high-level government officials going to military tribunals, and it's going to be shocking. It's going to be shocking what comes out about these people, like Hillary Clinton and the Obamas and all these bankers. And there's about 60,000 arrest warrants that are sealed, called sealed indictments, that have been generated since the Trump administration came in.
Really?
And so basically, what's going on is there's the Trump administration has been basically preparing the way for a lot of these people to be brought to justice. And as far as I understand it, you're going to see people like the Clintons and the Obamas and many, many, many high-level government officials being carted off to Guantanamo Bay and being tried via military tribunals. And the charges are going to be treason, human trafficking, all kinds of despicable acts that these people have been up to.
Where are you getting this?
I mean, there's multiple sources in the alternative media, but there's also, the mainstream media are starting to talk about it. I mean, Trump tweeted the other day, or he retweeted somebody's like meme that they put up with a load of these people behind bars, like
Really?
photoshopped, like Clinton, Mueller, Brennan, the Obamas, John Podesta, all these people who are involved in the Pizzagate scandal and stuff like that.
Yeah, that was really weird, that period when WikiLeaks was coming up to the election, and WikiLeaks was dumping like stuff, and it can take, I mean, It was really weird because the mainstream media were silent on it. They kind of reported the fact that it was coming out, but they didn't talk about any of the contents. And I don't know if it was like classified or whatever. I got no idea. No, it wasn't, was it? It was available for the public, wasn't it?
No, anybody could look at it. Yeah.
And but I noticed that it all went quiet. It all got swept under the rug. And it was really weird that period. I don't know what was going on, but there stuff was going on. I just don't know what it was because I was following it as best I could.
Yeah, well, I was looking at it, and it was I kind of at a certain point, but I had to stop because it was so disturbing that I just can't even look at this anymore. But what happened was the mainstream media finally reported on it, but in a way that when they tried to debunk it, the same thing happened with that Hampstead Heath scandal that happened a few years ago. The same tactics, they basically tried to debunk it. They put all these paid trolls out so that the real articles went down in the Google rankings onto the fourth page or whatever. Mm. And then they tried to turn it around on you know, the people who were exposing it. Same tactics, but you know, there's no way they can't stop what's coming now. It's all been set into place, and the stage has been set. I mean, I could go on and on about this, but if you go and look at, I can give you some links to some of the stuff, the material that's out there. There's a lot of material, and there's a lot of people saying the same thing. A lot of the independent researchers and journalists who are not a part of the mainstream media are reporting on this. Too many for it not to be true, and even the mainstream media are now having to report on this. You know, Hillary Clinton's being investigated. I don't know if you've seen that for the whole email thing, but there's also the kind of Uranium One scandal where they sold about 20% of the US's uranium to Russia,
right?
And then they projected that onto Trump, saying he's colluding with Russia.
Oh, it's nuts, isn't it? It gets really frustrating, doesn't it? This is part of the reason I'm moving house. I'm leaving Bristol. I'm going to Newport. And
oh, really? Wow.
Just for a fresh start. No, but the reason I mention it is for about 5 years, I spend a lot of time kind of doing yoga and doing like circus acrobatic stuff and handstands. Uh-huh. And those worlds are very left-leaning, very liberal. And it was driving me insane, you know, because a lot of people, they just repeat headlines. They don't actually.
Exactly.
And I got sick of it. I got to the point where I'm done. I'm out of here. I'm not going to yoga. I can't listen to these nonsense, these brain dead conversations. And like, I don't mind if people go and actually listen to like a full Trump speech but I cannot be in a conversation where people are just repeating headlines they've read. And
exactly.
like the Russia thing, you know, if you speak to the average person on the street, it's like, oh yeah, Trump colluding with Russia, and they won't know anything about the Uranium One thing, and they won't have anything to say about that. And the newspaper headlines are so, all the only thing they'll ever do is criticize Trump. There's no balanced reporting whatsoever, and it's mind-numbingly frustrating, isn't it, you know?
But it's dumb. It's just, it's stupid. And, mm. and you know, the way people are going on, it's like you said, they're just kind of spouting out these headlines that they've read. And they're just trying to appear to be good people.
Yeah.
That's really what it's about. It's like, oh, I don't want to say I'm, you know, pro-Trump or anything, because then I'll be ostracized and might get sacked or whatever. And I just think that people need to dig a bit deeper, really, with this stuff. I mean, I've been following Trump for a long time before he announced me as being a president, because I'm an entrepreneur, so I was following him. I read his books, and you know what I got from him was he was a very high caliber individual, very smart, not a moron like a lot of people spout. You know, how can a moron make that much money?
I completely agree.
You know, it's just not going to happen. So I've always known Trump was a high caliber individual. Yes, he's got a big ego. Yes, he's a bit narcissistic, but hey, you know, that's just, everybody's got their idiosyncratic forms of behavior, you know, and it's just a human like anybody. I can be an arsehole sometimes.
Mm. It, but I find he's the topic of Trump is a good litmus test, I find. Like, I don't mind if people have got like a sensible criticism of him, and they can give like a reasoned explanation of why, they don't agree with something he's done. If they're kind of rational about it, that's cool. I don't need everyone to be Trump fans. But
Exactly.
if I bring up the topic of Trump, and you just get this barrage of like, oh, he's a racist, sexist, bigot, homophobe,
Fucking
like, oh
hell.
man, that's all I need to know about that person. That's a level of clever
Exactly.
that I
That's
don't
where they're
need in
at.
my life. And it's a great test, actually.
It is actually. It's good. It's a good barometer, isn't it? I kind of I stopped talking about it, to be honest, Ben. I don't go on so much about it because I've just been so kind of attacked and slandered and blocked and all this stuff that I haven't got time. I've got time. I'm just keeping my mouth shut now. I'm posting a bit of political stuff, but I'm not really engaging in any conversations with people. And I've met some people here in Glastonbury who are kind of like following the kind of same kind of populist movement, which has been touted as racist and homophobic and whatever. Or how people like me just throw a spanner in the works with that kind of narrative because I'm mixed race. And there's a lot of black people in America who are following Trump now. His popularity among African Americans has actually doubled in the last couple of years
Well, I follow
just because of the
Candace
results.
Owens. Do you see Candace Owens, the young?
Yeah, I think she's brilliant. I really, really like her a lot. I think she's a very, very brave young lady.
For anybody listening that doesn't know her, she's a black conservative female sort of Trump fan, and it really, it does throw a spanner in the works, doesn't it? Because what
Does
the usual. What can you say about her? People
exactly.
that they only know how to call people sexist and racist. What are you supposed to say about a black female,
Exactly. Yeah. And she's, she's gorgeous and she's charismatic and so it kind of like I mean there's loads of people who hate her as well. I mean, I think with a lot of radical leftists, they've just got tunnel vision. They won't listen to any reason. They just got it got they've made their mind up. And they kind of just want it. They just want to punish somebody, and Trump's an easy target, I guess. But he doesn't care. That whole protest in London was, dumb, and actually embarrassing. Some of the people there were just so stupid, and just all they could say is, "Oh, Trump's causing global warming," or there's nothing. There was no substantial argument as to why they were there for most of the people.
I love when you see some of these videos that are done by like comedy conservatives, and they go around asking people why they're there and like why they dislike Trump. You can't get a straight answer out of
There's
anyone.
nothing of
They
substance.
got
It
no
is said.
idea why they're there.
There's nothing. Yeah, exactly. It's like, what a waste of time. You spent, and then all that money got spent, and all the taxpayer. It's just ridiculous. And I just think people should just go and do something worthwhile. Why aren't they campaigning? The dictators that came to London recently, Erdogan and what's the other guy's name? Anyway, some kind of dictator from a third world country came. Nobody was protesting that. And the Saudi prince came, which has got the worst human rights record of any country, as far as I can tell. He came, nobody was on the streets.
I mean,
Nobody was on the
there's slavery all over the world now, but the liberal left don't, they got nothing to say about that because, they're too busy talking about slavery 200 years ago.
Exactly. 200 years ago, guys. I mean, like, it's not affecting people now, other than they keep bringing it into their reality by focusing on it. I just think there's bigger things to think about. I mean, there's 10 million homeless children in Brazil right now. This is one of the things I say to the vegans. I say, you're going about animals, and it's like, what about humans? Have you got any compassion for people who are suffering on the planet? You don't talk about that, do you? I mean, I'm not for animal cruelty, but I just think it's a bit over the top the way some of these people go on. It's fascism.
Something I noticed, I used to be in the into the lawful rebellion, free man on the land kind of thing for a little, like a short period. I got really into it for about a year, 18 months, and then I realized it was kind of a waste of time. And what I noticed was people that get really hooked into these topics, these kind of crusades, I think it meets a lot of emotional needs. It makes you feel like you've got significance and importance and meaning and purpose. And I think whether we're talking about environmentalism or veganism or you know, whatever, anti-Trumpism, I think it goes beyond just being about the subject matter for a lot of people, and they get a kick out of being irate about something. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Like I was saying, it's like they want to punish somebody, and so they just latch on to the easiest target. And it's like, you know, you can blame the government all day long for the wrongs of reality, but at the end of the day, you are the common denominator. It's you. You're doing it. There's nobody doing anything to you. You create your own reality totally and completely. There's no fine print to that. There's no asterisk. It's you. And a lot of people don't want to own that fact. And they're the people who aren't doing too well. We noticed. They don't want to take responsibility for the reality they create. And then they end up giving their power away to somebody else.
Yeah.
And it's sad, really. It's sad because they could have so much more in their reality if they would just own the fact that they're doing it.
Yes, I agree. Yeah.
You know, and everybody wants to play the blame game. Not everybody, obviously, but you know, a lot of people, and they get caught up in this kind of self-pitying victim narrative.
Yeah.
And it really just is very destructive, because all it does is it creates, if you're feeling sorry for yourself, all you're going to do is create more reasons to feel sorry for yourself.
I think one of the good things that's come out of this Trump era is it's really highlighted all this stuff, hasn't it? It's like it's turned up the volume and the contrast and the everything on all this stuff, and it's made it very visible, hasn't it? You know, people's outlook on life, people's attitude towards the world is more noticeable than ever now.
Well, yeah, people are really showing their true colours, aren't they? And I think one of the most amazing things that's come out of it, really, is the debunking of the mainstream media. I mean, it already lost a lot of credibility, but I think Trump has just, you know, nobody believes this stuff anymore, which is amazing. This the fact that movie, Above Majestic, is so popular is amazing to me, because it's very out there stuff. It's not your average documentary. Okay. Some of the stuff in it is just it's shocking and will leave people incredulous as to whether it's true or not. But there are a lot of insiders who've come forth now, and all the evidence, all the information corroborates. I haven't seen any, you know, any stuff where I've said, oh, well, that doesn't line up. It all lines up completely.
Well, I'm definitely going to watch that. I hadn't heard of it.
It's very interesting, Ben. It'll definitely change the way you look at reality. I mean, I've been actually blown away by it, because, like I said, a couple of years ago, I would have been like, oh, this is bullshit, mate. Just give me a break. I haven't got time for this. But, you know, because of the sequence of events that led up to me, you know, coming to this place, it was all very, very validated by all the different components.
Okay.
If that makes sense. Otherwise, I would have been just like, okay, whatever, maybe. It's interesting. It's a bit interesting bit of entertainment, but it's worth watching. It's worth watching.
Well,
and the most exciting thing, really, is the technology, the technological advances that we potentially could move towards if this stuff all comes out. I mean, it's probably going to get worse before it gets better, though. I'll send you some links on this stuff. It's really worth looking at what's actually going on the planet. It's very, very interesting.
No, I'm definitely going to watch that. I can put the links on the description for this podcast as well, so people can check out. That's great. So in terms of yourself, like, what's your sort of medium-term goals with the business and stuff, and how can people find your products?
Well, basically, previously, when I was doing this other company, what I was doing was I was a manufacturer, and I was going, you know, the traditional business model, which is manufacturer, distributor, retailer. But what I found was that it's a bit of a difficult game, really. And you've got all these sharks, who want to take siphon off the profits. And I just got to a point where I thought, you know what, I can't. I'm not doing this anymore. I'm just working to just pay bills, basically. So I kind of downgraded a bit, got rid of a load of my overheads, and decided to do this other company. And what I'm going to do is I'm not doing distributors, so I'm only going to do direct sales to independent health food stores and private clients. And I want to create like an auto ship program on the website where people can buy at retail, or if they want to subscribe, they can get like 20-25% off. So rather than giving all the money to retailers and distributors, I want to give it to the end client and just go direct as possible. So what I'm doing is I've gone back into studying internet marketing, and I'm just going the route of building up a network now and building a list and creating some free giveaways and information products, and building a network with through content creation and stuff like that, so as to just go direct to the public as much as possible, and just getting into like just fulfilling a lot of the orders myself through the internet and a local kind of delivery route. And I think, I did the math on it before I came out of Excalibur, and I realized I don't really have to even make that many sales relatively to make, a six-figure income from it. Obviously, I'll be open to making more than that, but to make a really, really quite a nice income, it won't really take that much.
That's great. Is it already in production in its new form?
Yeah, it's ready now. We've got all the labels and all that kind of stuff ready. So, also, what I'm doing, Ben, is I'm doing these. I got a very strong message about 6 months ago. I went to see this psychic. He's a really good psychic, actually, a tarot guy. And he said to me, you're going to be successful, but you just got to get back into creativity. You got to get back into, being creative. And I wish I wasn't doing, because I was just spending too much time just working in a factory, basically. So I just decided to ditch that, and since then I've gotten back into music again. I'm DJing again. I'm doing my artwork, and I'm writing. I'm writing a book at the moment on fermentation, and I just want to get into immediate. I'm doing an online course as well. And I really, like I said, I'm doing this internet marketing thing. I want to get back into media and do more things like this podcast, and just more fun, more creativity.
Yeah, that makes sense. More all well-rounded, just sort of creative expression.
Just expressing myself more rather than just going through, this kind of rote, kind of humdrum process of, banging out fermented foods. It just took the fun out of it, really. So now, I just want to do that, like, and do more workshops, and just have more fun. I spend more time with my son, really. That's been really, really amazing. So yeah, I'm really excited about what's going on. You can find us at avataralchemy.co.uk or avataralchemical.co. At the moment, it's Avatar Alchemical, but we're going to reroute it into Avatar Alchemy as well. We're going to have two URLs that go to the same place. The website's under construction at the moment. We're not quite finished with it, but we've got some Instagram. We've got an Instagram page called Avatar Alchemy. You can find us there. And I'm generally, around town in Glastonbury, spending more time at home these days. But just going to get my head down for the winter and start building. Going to write this book, and just get into the whole kind of residual income flow again.
Yeah, fantastic. That's great, Kenny. I'm really pleased for you. Yeah, I'm getting back in touch with like sort of the stuff where I feel like I'm able to be myself more as well. I felt like I spent a long time kind of, having to watch what I say and stuff, but now I'm really just doing the things I enjoy, surrounding myself with the people that, that are on my wavelength, and I feel like I'm much more able to sort of be my true self. So it sounds like we're on a, kind of a similar
Similar
path.
path. Are you moving to Wales?
Only to Newport, and so it's not too far away. It's only about half hour from Bristol. And
Oh, is it? Is it that close?
yeah, it's just over the bridge, pretty much.
Oh, wow.
And I travel around quite a bit anyway, because I teach handstand workshops all around the country. So I'm kind of on the motorway all the time anyway, so it doesn't really make
Oh,
much
cool.
difference to me. And I've got
How
some.
are you getting that out there? How are you marketing that? You just got connections in different parts of the country?
No, I do it all with Facebook ads. I don't have any connections. I
Oh,
just
wow.
yeah, I just target ads at a region. So I book like a village hall or a fitness studio or something, and then you can. I've got like sort of adverts, and I can just target it at kind of yoga
Oh,
people
wow.
in that region. It's really simple, actually.
So do you just do that on Facebook, or do you phone them up?
No, just on Facebook. It's just Facebook ads.
Oh,
It's
wow. Do you have to spend quite a bit of money, or?
I mean, I do spend money on it, but it's very easy to monitor. You can see the return you're getting and how much you're
Oh, wow.
spending. So it's very, you can see how many people have clicked and how much each co so it's very easy to monitor it,
Oh, wow. That sounds cool, actually. I might do that for our New Year's Eve event, actually.
Right. What's the event?
Yeah, we're doing these pop-up kind of ecstatic dance events. I did one in November. That was really quite successful, actually. We had quite a good turnout.
Okay.
And New Year's Eve, we're going to do one. We've got a cacao ceremony to begin with, which my missus is going to facilitate. And then we're going to just have DJs and our kind of herbal elixir bar, which is going to have like our fermented Jun kombucha drink, as well as like herbal kind of tonic herbal hot chocolates, with like bulletproof CBD coffees and raw chocolate and stuff like that.
Wow.
So we're getting people, on a, in a kind of a drug-free, kind of alcohol-free atmosphere with like herbal highs and really good kind of like funky electronic new jazz kind of music.
Oh, awesome.
It's fun, actually. It's fun. And we got like a little plant-based cafe going as well. So,
Hey, I might come. Is there tickets left?
yeah. I'll send you the link. It's New Year's Eve. Going to be fun till about 2 o'clock.
Great.
It's right on Glastonbury High Street.
Great. Hey, send me all the links of all the stuff you mentioned, all your websites and the movies and that thing as well, and I'll put it all
Yeah, I'll send it over
on the
for sure. I'll
page.
send it over in a minute. So you're going to go back and edit this and.
Yeah, I should have this up tonight, so I'll
Oh,
upload it
really?
as soon as I can. I'll send you the links as soon as it's up. Yeah.
Oh, fantastic. Sounds
It'll
great,
be
then.
on iTunes, SoundCloud, Spotify, YouTube, you name it.
Oh, that sounds amazing. I'd love to have a chat to you about it, actually, what you're doing and stuff like that, because I wanted to start one myself, so.
Sure, yeah, I'll be happy to. I'll come down sometime. We can hang out and
Yeah, next time you're in Glastonbury, just give us a bell. I'll send you my number as well, and then we can hang out.
Yeah, wicked. That's great, Kenny. Thanks ever so much. I really enjoyed the conversation.
Yeah, it was good talking to you, Ben, and I hope you have a great rest of the week.
Yeah,
And
yeah.
thanks for everybody for listening.
Yeah. All right, Kenny. Speak to you soon.
All right, bro, take care.
Bye.
Bye.